Hello students, I once again welcome you all to class 6 of American Realism. In my last class I was talking about the issue as to whether there lies a line in the realm of ought for the purposes of adjudication for judges, and that every judge, regardless of the fact that he or she is actually adjudicating and interpreting in the realm of ought, needs to stick to that line and must not try and cross it. In this reference, I had referred to Ronald Dworkin's work, wherein Ronald Dworkin has emphasized the fact that in the realm of ought, lies several legal principles, even the ones which are not recognized even once. And those principles in fact act as the justification for legal rights. And therefore, to that extent, every judge must travel into the realm of ought so as to identify those legal principles and apply it. We know that in Riggs versus Palmer example, Ronald Dworkin has also cited the fact that at times legal principles may actually be in conflict, and therefore in such cases the judge will have to choose as to which one is to be preferred over the other. And he has also said that even if one principle is to be discarded in that case, but that principle still remains part of law and still remains legal principle. But what is important for the purposes of our present discussion is that Ronald Dworkin is arguing that that in the realm of ought also it is actually possible to stick to what is the adjudicatory sphere, and therefore the judges must not travel beyond this adjudicatory sphere in the realm of ought. And that realm, which is not the adjudicatory realm, is identified by Ronald Dworkin as the realm of policy questions, which according to him are the questions to be entertained and determined by the executive and the legislature. And I also talked about the fact as to how this, even today, remains the most acceptable theoretical normative standard for a legitimate adjudicatory role, wherein we every now and then see that it is being told and it is being reiterated by judges themselves that judges must remain within the realm of law and judges must not travel into the realm of policy. And when they say realm of law, they very clearly say that that realm of law is not confined just to black letter law, but the realm of ought as well. But by making that distinction between law and policy, what is being actually emphasized is the fact that even in the realm of ought, realm of law is limited. And therefore the entire realm of ought is not available to a judge for the purposes of adjudication. Only that realm which is covered under the ambit of law is the adjudicatory realm. The realm of ought covers the realm of law and the realm of policy. So the realm of policy is not the realm of judges for the purposes of their adjudicatory function. And we had seen that how this particular understanding and this particular normative standard is something which is consistent with the constitutional doctrine of separation of power, because it recognizes that even though black letter law does not exhaust the realm of law, nevertheless, though permitting travel into the realm of ought, still the doctrine of separation of power ensures that the judges must not treat the entire space of ought as the space of law. And therefore the relevance of doctrine of separation of power remains. As opposed to this, we have seen Professor Bakshi arguing in relation to public interest litigations as to how the separation of power doctrine is not something which can be said to be the universal prescription, and regardless of historical context, you apply it as if this is the fundamental principles of any constitutional system. And he has therefore disagreed with Professor Dworkin by citing that Professor Dworkin perhaps is not telling us the historical prescription of constitutional governance. And we also saw how while replying to Professor Bakshi, Professor Dworkin has admitted that probably he doesn't have the experience of the working of the constitutionalism of Global South, of which India is a part, and therefore Bakshi may be right probably when he says that that even when it comes to the constitutional doctrine of separation of power, the constitutional history and the development, the historical context of a particular legal system cannot be ignored, and therefore to that extent the separation of power needs to accommodate the concerns of history, and therefore a universal prescription of constitutional doctrine of separation of power is not possible. However, we have also seen that that Professor Bakshi has gone on to the extent of saying that a doctrine like separation of power is inapplicable to India. This, though very radical, is nevertheless a suggestion and nevertheless a recommendation coming from none other than Professor Bakshi, which even today remains very contested and an argument for which there are very few takers, because this entire approach is based on justifying judicial intervention based on its outcomes, whereas any argument which is wherein you are trying to address the issue of separation of power, that those interventions, judicial interventions, cannot be examined from the point of view of outcome of those judicial interventions. Now, Professor Bakshi, because by citing public interest litigation, is actually saying that the outcome of judicial interventions in public interest litigation, especially in addressing the cause of marginalized, has been something which is phenomenal, which is very appreciable to the cause of deepening of Indian social democracy, is actually insisting upon looking at the legitimacy question of judicial intervention from the point of view of outcome such interventions have produced. But the opponents disagree with this view. They say this outcome-oriented approach to examining the legitimacy of judicial intervention is flawed, because when we are looking at judicial intervention, what we are primarily interested in as to whether a particular judicial intervention at the first instance is legitimate or not. And therefore, it is a question of the very entry of judicial intervention into an otherwise a space which is not permissible. So therefore, examining such interventions based on the outcome produced by such interventions is a flawed approach, because doctrine of separation of power determines for the courts what is the domain wherein they cannot enter, whereas outcome-oriented approach presupposes that entry is fine so long as the outcome of the entry is something which is worthy of appreciation, and therefore this remains very contested. If you read Gautam Bhatia's blog also, he also is a very vehement critique of this outcome-oriented approach to adjudication, and he disagrees with Professor Bakshi to always, and he has always endorsed a recent book which has come on public interest litigation, written by another NLS Bangalore graduate and presently a faculty at Ambedkar University, Delhi, who in his book, quoting the people, public interest litigation in India, has again vehemently disagreed with this approach of looking at judicial interventions through the prism of the outcome produced, and he has disagreed with this by saying that this kind of intervention is probably undemocratic. Not probably, he has said it in categorical terms that it is in fact undemocratic. So therefore, this as I said, that there are very few takers of this idea that the outcome is in fact the yardstick to determine the legitimacy of the judicial intervention, and therefore the popular narrative, the acceptable narrative, still remains that there is a line in the realm of ought, and one side of the line belongs to law and therefore becomes the adjudicatory space, whereas the other side is a space exclusively meant for legislature and executive, and therefore judicial intervention is impermissible in that space. Moving on. Now, as I had said in my last class also, that the courts in India follow an approach wherein they always take this to be the binding rule, the guiding rule, that the questions of policy are not the domain of legislature, not the domain of judiciary. And they have always, so far as the normative principle of judicial, legitimate judicial intervention is concerned, they have always endorsed this Dworkinian line of remaining within law and not traveling into the realm of policy, in the realm of ought. However, what remains contested, even in this backdrop, that the courts accept this argument that the policy questions are not adjudicatory questions, why is it that the judicial intervention has always been a bone of contention between judiciary and the government in India? It is because of the fact that the courts probably have drawn the line in the realm of ought in such a manner that several of the policy questions, according to court, have actually been covered in the realm of law. So, despite accepting this distinction, that policy questions are not adjudicatory questions, what in fact is the charge against the Indian courts is that they have been very liberal, very generous in drawing the line of law in the realm of ought, and by this generous drawing of line, several of the policy questions have actually been read as questions of legal rights by the Indian courts. So, despite the fact that they accept the argument of policy questions not being adjudicatory, they are actually trying to act against this very fundamental principle by not disagreeing with this fundamental principle, by actually giving a very liberal space to law in the realm of ought, and thereby restricting the realm of policy in the realm of ought. So the policy question becomes a very small space in the realm of ought, whereas the space of law in the realm of ought has been accorded a very wider space. This is the argument. And this is the bone of contention between the legislature and executive and judiciary. Now, for example, what I discussed can be understood by way of this example. Now, Article 37 of the Constitution says that the provisions of directive principles of state policy, that is contained in Part 4 of the Indian Constitution, are not to be enforced by any court. And though it also says that this is fundamental in the governance of the country, but at the same time says that it is not enforceable in a court of law. Now, the unamended Article 45 of the Directive Principle of State Policy stated that the state shall endeavor to provide within a period of 10 years, and mind you, this 10 year from 1950. So, the state shall endeavor to provide within a period of 10 years from the commencement of this constitution for free and compulsory education of all children until they complete the age of 14 years. Now, that means by 1960, state shall provide free and compulsory education for all children until they complete the age of 14 years. Now, by 1990, the state did not provide free and compulsory education to all children until the age of 14 years. That means the state is falling short of its commitment, constitutional commitment, by 30 years. And yet, if you go by the letters of Article 37, no judicial intervention is actually possible to undo or to make the state realize that it is not doing something which was fundamental in the governance of the country and which it was mandated to do by 1960. Now, what has happened, therefore, as the consequence of this indifference on the part of the executive and the legislature? In 1993, Supreme Court of India held that right to primary education up to the age of 14 years forms part of the fundamental right to life flowing from Article 21. Now, this kind of reading is, if one goes by the letters of Article 37 of the Constitution, which makes directive principles of state policy not enforceable in a court of law, appear problematic, because one would say this is a policy question, and therefore the question that the dimension of fundamental right to life cannot be interpreted and stretched to such an extent so as to make policy questions also fall within it, and therefore this kind of approach is incorrect. Now, if you look at this right to education question, one probably would understand that but for Article 45 giving a mandate of 10 years to achieve the objective of free and compulsory education for children up to 14 years, the court would not have interfered in such a manner so as to have such a liberal interpretation of right to life, whereby right to primary education is also read into it. You must also be knowing that prior to this, in Mohini Jain case in 1992, the Supreme Court has gone on to the extent of saying that right to education, even university education, forms part of right to life under Article 21. But in next year, in this Unnikrishnan case, the court reduce the ambit of right to education, which can actually be read as part of right to life under Article 21, by saying that not university education, not higher secondary education, but it's only primary education up to the age of 14 years, which is actually the fundamental right flowing from Article 21. And this, and for this, Article 45 gives a very important foundation for the court to say that. And therefore, to that extent, even if the court has ignored the mandate of Article 37, this kind of intervention is probably justified, because if the executive and the legislature has completely closed their eyes to such constitutional imperatives, if the courts also would not interfere, then even constitutional imperatives like Article 45 mandating 10 years to realize free and compulsory education for children up to 14 years would become simply a hollow promise. And therefore, this intervention appears justified. Now, judgments like Unnikrishnan and Mohini Jain, they have originated out of the recognition of another very important idea in Article 21, wherein in a judgment delivered by Justice Bhagwati in Francis Corelli Moulin versus Union Territory of Delhi in 1981, he had held that right to life means right to live with human dignity. And this to live with human dignity is such an important aspect that one would probably agree that a person is not living a dignified life if the person does not have access to food, does not have access to even primary education, does not have access to shelter, does not have access to health and medical care. And if you look at this slide, by way of different judgments, the courts, the Supreme Court, by way of its innovative interpretation, has held all this to be falling within Article 21, right to life, which the court had read as right to life of human dignity. And in this backdrop, all these recognitions of basic human needs have actually fallen in Article 21. But what is also important to note is that this health and medical care, shelter, nutrition, food, education, all these concerns find mention in Part 4 in the form of directive principles of state policy. But what has happened is that by insisting upon the concept of human dignity, the courts have actually said that these basic human needs form part of right to life under Article 21, because but for access to these needs, no human being can be said to be living a life of human dignity. But what this otherwise very acceptable explanation has done is that it has made several of the issues which were exclusively the issues of executive and legislature under Part 4, adjudicatory issues. Because if something would fall in Article 21, that means Article 21 being an enforceable fundamental right, one can approach the court with this plea that the executive and the legislature must be forced to comply with its obligations emanating from the directive principles of state policy, by saying that these are no more mere directive principles of state policy, rather these have now become fundamental rights flowing from right to life under Article 21. Now, as you could see, that for issues like shelter, health and medical care, food and nutrition, you do not have a corresponding provision like right to primary education in the form of Article 45, the unamended Article 45. For these issues, you do not have the kind of justification which may actually be there for right to primary education being read as a fundamental right. And yet, the concept of recognition of human dignity under Article 21 is such that it has enabled the courts to argue that access to basic human needs forms part of right to live with human dignity. Now, what therefore has happened, if you look at it carefully, that the court, by this innovative reading of right to life, what the court is actually doing, the court is extending the boundaries of what is legal in the realm of ought. And therefore, this has resulted in restricting the boundaries of policy questions. Now, the court, while is still advocating that policy questions are not adjudicatory questions, but at the same time, what the court has done, an otherwise policy question, a question which was prior to these judgments policy questions, have actually been made the questions of fundamental rights. So this is a very liberal drawing of the boundaries of law, which has resulted in the extension of the boundaries of law, extension of the boundaries of legal principles, extension of the justification for fundamental rights. And this therefore becomes the bone of contention between the government and the judiciary, that the court is not respecting the constitutional doctrine of separation of power, whereas the court would say we still respect that underlying principle that the policy questions are not adjudicatory questions. But what has happened, that traditionally understood non-adjudicatory question, because of such innovative interpretations, have become adjudicatory questions, enforceable in the court of law, and this appears to be ignoring the mandate of Article 37, which says that the provisions of Part 4 are not to be enforced in any court. And this therefore is a major bone of contention between the judiciary and the government, even in contemporary times. So with this, I conclude my today's talk. The idea was to actually give you certain examples to actually understand the point which I was actually trying to make in my last class. Hope I could convey what I wanted to. If you have any doubts, which I think you must have, because these are not that superficial concepts to understand, so please feel write to me at please feel free to write to me at manvendra.dnlu@gmail.com with your questions and observations. I'll be very happy to entertain your queries. Thank you very much. Have a good day.